Learn how to improve performance of bulk loading data using Query Store Hints this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Denzel, a program manager on the Azure SQL team. Denzel, thanks so much for joining us today. Can you start by telling us a little bit about what you do?
Sure. I'm a program manager in the hyperscale team, and I work with customers to determine what's the roadmap, look at compete and features that we're going to release, and make sure they solve the business scenarios that customers want us to solve.
Awesome. Cool. Well, we are happy to have you on the show today. And today we're going to be talking about query store hints, specifically how you can use them to optimize your data loading. So can you kind of maybe start us off by telling us a little bit more about this scenario?
Sure. So data loading is a common scenario. And now with hyperscale supporting larger sizes of databases, there are customers who use ETL to load data. And loading data is unique in many ways. And optimizing data load depends on a bunch of factors. Today, we're going to look at a specific scenario of memory grants and where query store hints can help us in scenarios that we cannot change our ETL process yet need to optimize it.
Okay, got it. And then just a quick background for folks like myself that might not know a ton about memory grants. Can you give us kind of some more information on what those actually are?
Sure. So when a query executes, it needs to request some memory that it reserves for joins and sorts and query execution. This is not memory for the data pages themselves, which is buffer pool. And so this grant is affected by parallelism, how many CPUs and what parallel plan you have, the resources on the system. And it's set to a percentage, which by default is 25% of your default workload group. And the reason the reservation is done is you don't want the query to run out of memory during execution, so we reserve up front. So when there are many queries that require large grants, these wait until there's available memory on the system, and that's what we're going to look at today.
Awesome, cool. And we're also going to be using something called query store hints, which is also pretty new for Azure SQL Database. Is that right?
That's correct. So awesome. Query store hints isn't there on-premise SQL servers yet. It's on Azure SQL first. So in this scenario, we are going to actually load data via Spark. And we have an 8-node cluster in Spark. I'm loading from Data Lake. So you'll see a bunch of files that I'm loading. I'm loading about 9.6 gigs in total. And so the first frame I've already read in this data set so as to not calculate kind of read time. And I'm loading into a table, which is a column store table. So for column store, we optimize the batch load so that the load goes into compressed row groups directly. The max size of a row group is around 1 million. So that's what we are giving as a batch size. And then we're just appending to the table. So for column store, we don't want to specify a tab lock, unlike when you load to a heap. So these are the only options that are relevant. And then I'm using Spark to actually kick off my load. So there I'm kicking off my load into the table. And this is an 8-node Spark cluster, each with 4 cores. So you have a total of 32 tasks which are loading. As you can see here, there are 32 tasks which are loading data. And these files are partitioned by the tasks, and each of them are loading data, right? So let's come back to the SQL Server side of the house and see how this looks. So I'm loading into this table called Customer Ratings. You can see it's a pretty wide table. I have 100 columns or so, which is not uncommon in the Data Mart scenario. And I have a column store index here, which is a clustered column store. So data, the base data is actually compressed into row groups and segments. So it's stored by column. If I look at the running requests, and this is just a stored procedure I wrote on top of DM exec requests. The key part is we're going to look at a lot of bulk inserts. We'll see 32 of these bulk inserts here. Right. And more interestingly, let's give it a little bit of time and look at the wait types. And we see quite a few of these resource semaphore wait types. And as you can see, this is the wait time. So this time, if I run it again, it keeps increasing because there's no memory available to grant.
Right.
Right. So this is the resource semaphore wait time I was talking about on the slide. So how do we look at these grants? So what are these grants? And how do we look at you know, how much is requested and how much is granted? We have two DMVs here. One is this DM exec query memory grants. So if we run this, we see a session ID, the degree of parallelism, and we see these couple columns. You see a request time and a grant time. The ones which the grant time is populated have been granted. The ones which are null are waiting. Right, and then you have a requested memory, granted memory, and then you have a used memory, which I'll show you in a second. So whatever is requested is granted in this case, but we can see from the used memory, much less is used than is actually granted. So you have about a 3 gig grant and just about 280 MB kind of used. And this grant is based on an estimation and heuristics, and there are particular schemas where estimation may not be accurate, and this is one of them. Then if we look at the semaphore itself, and this pool ID is the workload group for default user queries, I see that 12 of these requests have been granted, and 20 of these are waiting for a grant. And you know, you get other heuristics of what's the available memory and what's the granted memory and what's the used memory for that pool. But this is the important number, which shows you, you know, all the threads which are waiting on a memory grant, right? So similarly, you can look at wait stats snapshots, and I'll show a dashboard in a second. So these are diffs between two snapshots. So I'm running it again, and maybe the grant actually already went past. You know, maybe the other queries have already got past that grant, but we can look at the dashboard, you know, to see if there was waits on a grant or not. So this is Telegraph on monitoring SQL Server. I can see in my wait stats here, I have this resource semaphore, and this is cumulative wait time per second. So there's 9 seconds of wait time per elapsed second, which wow, indicates there's a wait, right? So queries are being throttled on that. So how do I identify these queries? So I'm going to actually just look at bulk insert. So there are two ways to do it. One is this more comprehensive query, which looks at runtime stats and orders it by the query, max memory used, which is recorded in query store, right? So I can look at that and I see that you know, the statement is insert bulk. Well, insert bulk is not really a statement that you can issue from T-SQL. Usually the statement is bulk insert, but insert bulk is issued by any application that is actually calling the SQL bulk copy API. So you don't have direct control over this statement. It is the API which actually generates this insert bulk statement. And as you can see, I mean, the average query memory used is quite high. The important part is I need this query ID. That's all I actually need in this case. It's 32. And so what will I do with this 32? I am actually going to use a hint, which I otherwise could use on select queries and such, and then force it via this hints to this query ID, which is 32. So I force this hint, and then I can look at hints from this hints view and see that, okay, this query ID 32 now has this hint, you know, forced. Now, in the interest of time, okay, we did finish. It was about 5 minutes and such. Now that we've applied the query store hint, let's rerun this again and look at the same set of diagnostics that we did before. So we'll look at requests. And if you look at waits, those resource semaphore waits that we were looking at before are now gone. You don't see them anymore because we've lowered the max grant that each query can get. Similarly, looking at the other grant DMVs, all the queries in question have been granted. The grant itself is much lower. It was 3.5 gigs or so. It's now 500 megs. And then the used is much closer. So there was enough available memory to grant all the 32 bulk inserts the memory that they required. And there are no waiters. All 32 of these have been granted, and there are no waiters anymore. So similarly, if we look at wait stats, there won't be any waits on resource semaphores. That just disappears because there aren't any waiters. One more thing I wanted to identify is, via the query plan, when you have a query plan, there always is a way to look at memory grants. This is not the query plan for the bulk insert, but you can always look at a query plan and see the memory grant from a query plan perspective as well. So that's another diagnostic besides query store and the DMVs to help identify the queries that are granting a lot of memory. So last but not the least, some of the results, if you look at the difference in results, and I'll switch back to a dashboard that shows this, the load time now reduces from what was closer to anywhere from 5 to 7 minutes, depending on the run and amount of waiters, to closer to 2.5 minutes or less. Wow. from a load time perspective. So that's a phenomenal increase. More importantly, even besides the load, you see usage of resources fundamentally better, right? Load generation rate was only 21 megs per second. It goes to 49 megs per second. CPU goes up because now we don't have waiters, so there are more threads actually utilizing the CPU to compress the row groups. And then your resource semaphore, here was a sample run that I ran before, drops from a wait of 4,000 seconds to 0 seconds. And literally to cement this case, I have a dashboard that compares these two runs. And you will see this is the duration of the waits. You see these are CPU, average CPU is about 20%, right. Whereas it goes much higher here and much shorter duration. From the waits perspective, you see the same thing. The first part has resource semaphore waits. The second part has nothing. We start bottlenecking on CPU here a little bit. But that can always, you can always scale up if CPU is your bottleneck. So that's the advantage of query store hints. I didn't have to change my app. I could still apply the hints and fundamentally improve performance of my data loads.
Wow, this is really cool. That was a really cool demo. And I also learned like a lot of different things. But this has been really useful. So thanks so much. You know, as folks are just getting started with this, do you have any like tips or gotchas that people should be aware of?
Look, explore query store hints for sure. In many of the cases where you have third-party applications where you need to change a query and a change in query results in the application vendor having to generate a patch, it's a quick way for a DBA to mitigate an issue that happens in production in a short duration of time. Query store is key, and identifying queries and troubleshooting query store should be something all data engineers are very familiar with. And then hyperscale also enables this data loading scenarios because irrespective of compute size, in this case, I had just 16-core hyperscale database, and I loaded the 9 and 6.6 gigs of data in roughly over 2 minutes in column store format, right? So hyperscale also has this log generation rate not tied to the size of compute and is a great way to kind of move workloads that are data intensive to hyperscale tier.
Awesome. Cool. Well, thanks so much again for coming on the show. To our viewers, thanks for joining us. We will put some links in the description for you to go learn more and catch our other videos where we've talked about query store hints. Thanks so much for joining us today, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.
Thank you, Anna.